that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercy, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, and may the eyes of your heart be enlightened. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. So we have the coincidence of a number of things that take place on this Sunday. First of all, it's Mother's Day, so we have to give a great act of gratitude and love to the mothers who are among us. The second, May 13th, is also commemorating Our Lady of Fatima. And today is also the feast of Saint Adai, Mor Adai. Adai was one of the 72 disciples in the Gospel that were sent out to prepare around Samaria and Galilee during our Lord's ministry, his arrival in different villages and towns. But Adai later on becomes one of the disciples who sent out with St. Thomas to Mesopotamia. So he's one of the main apostles of Edessa and Mesopotamia, and hence very much linked with the Syriac church. When you go into the church of the chapel of St. Jude, the front stained glass window towards the altar, with King Abgar sick and reclining in his chair, and a man holding the image of our Lord's face on a veil, that's Mor Adai, that's St. Adai, bringing the veil to St. Abgar to heal him of our Lord's image. So we have that along with the epistle. We have four different sermons we could do, but fortunately we're not going to do them. We're only going to do one. And we're going to do this epistle. But saying that in the letter to the Ephesians, this is written about the year 60. So it's slightly a few years after the letter to the that we saw last week to the Philippians, or no, Acts, never mind. Corinthians. I forget. Doesn't matter. This is one of my senior moments. So this letter is one of the what we call the letters of captivity. St. Paul is dictating this letter from Rome, in which he's under house arrest. And it's not house arrest in the sense that we have today, where they put an electronic bracelet around your ankle, because they don't have electronics. But they still have bracelets, and they still have anklets. And so St. Paul, under his house arrest, for the couple of years that he was under arrest, meant that he always had, chained with his ankle, chained to him, a Roman soldier, with him all the time. That's how you were under house arrest. And a number of these letters are dictated, and one of them being this letter to the Ephesians. What is also fascinating about this letter is, though the vast majority of the manuscripts that we have are written to the Ephesians, there are a notably large number of manuscripts which don't have Ephesians written in. And so it seems that this letter, historically, was also meant for a larger readership than just at Ephesus. And the last detail for you to keep in mind, and as I always do, I encourage you to go back and read the first chapter of this letter, because this is our quotation today, is the second half of the first chapter. Now, the letter to the Ephesians is kind of twinned with the letter to the Colossians. And what the letter to the Ephesians is about primarily is St. Paul's definitive teaching, description, explanation of soteriology. Now, soteriology is probably not a word that you had in your catechism when you were eight, but you should all know it as adults. Soter in Greek means savior, and as bios, bios means life in Greek, and biology is the study or the explanation of life. So, soteriology is the explanation or study of the work of redemption, of the Savior. So, soteriology. And so that brings us to the quotation, the beginning of this epistle today. We do not often think of the Catholic life as being one of contemplation. Priests do that. Monks do that. The sisters do that. We don't think about our life as being transformed by our prayer life of contemplation, but that's exactly what St. Paul says in the letter to the Ephesians today. It's the request that he makes that may the eyes of your heart be enlightened. We'll come back to that in a moment. In this epistle, what St. Paul is talking about continually is this life in Christ. And the basic idea is that what happens in our Lord, his entrance into time, his ministry, his teaching, his gospel, his betrayal, death, resurrection, and movement into ascension of what takes place in him individually is poured forth upon all of his disciples. And that's precisely the key to the word disciple. Our Lord did not seek followers, people who were just there. He sought disciples. And as I mentioned to you numerous times, the word disciple is from the Latin discere, which means to learn. Disciple is someone who is there to learn something, not just simply to follow, because it's a miracle worker. And so what St. Paul says, that what you're living in Christ is the pouring forth of that grace which is spread out, poured forth throughout time and space in the mystery that we call the assembly, the church, that reality that we profess in the creed, that we believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We profess our faith in the reality of this thing from generation to generation that connects us with our Lord. Of course, the biggest problem of our faith in the church is the members of the church. Because we're not perfect. We do a lot of things that are stupid, a lot of things that are sinful. But the reality that we profess our faith is that we all belong as disciples to learn and to live in Christ. So what happens in our Lord is then spread out to the church. Which is why St. Paul says that may the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, give you the spirit of wisdom to see, and the spirit of revelation, that as we move along, things continually to be unveiled to us, that we see more and more profoundly the hand of God in our lives, and in history, the way it works, and how everything is moving towards the day of judgment. Yes, even what apparently culturally is the chaos and insanity that we are surrounded with today. It all works under the hand of God, mysteriously. And hence, the development in those learners, the disciples, to be able to see more clearly in wisdom, to see more clearly with this unveiling of revelation, and in the knowledge of Him, of Christ, as all these things play out in our lives. So that St. Paul lays out here that at the age of 140, I should be seeing more clearly than I saw when I was 90. And I should see Christ more profoundly in the events and circumstances and people around me than I did at 90. And at 90, wisdom is meant to be a characteristic of my life and a vision of revelation more than it was when I was 50. And when I was 50, that wisdom and revelation should be greater than when I was 21. This idea is that we develop. Now, historically and traditionally, especially in the first centuries of the church, we always referred to baptism as illumination. It is the moment in which life was given into the spirit of this individual. But it's not a once-off thing done. And that's what St. Paul is saying to us. We are initiated and enlightened, and the enlightenment and illumination is meant to penetrate deeper and deeper and more profoundly into that person. And that requires the engagement of faith, of loyalty, of fidelity, and the desire to learn. For the person who has other things to do, soccer on Sunday morning, going out to the good sale at Kohl's on Sunday, whatever it might be, we find something different to do than the divine sacrifice of the Eucharist. That is a statement of belief. And I have said that I believe Kohl's is more important than our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I haven't said that verbally, it sounds horrible, especially if I think I'm a member of the church. And yet, the way that I live means that I move further and further and further away. Necessarily because I'm not, all those days and years that are gone, I have learned nothing. I have not participated in the mysteries. I have not entered into that desire to receive the spirit of wisdom and of revelation. And that is why St. Paul, what he is saying to us today, is that that in Christ in which we live, is that what takes place in him is historically that we've been commemorating his death, his resurrection, his ascension last Thursday, is the junction between now and next Sunday, which is Pentecost, the epiphany of the body of Christ, the revelation of the church on the day of Pentecost, which is why he sums it all up in the one phrase, may the eyes of your heart be enlightened. Now that sounds very poetic, but what does it actually mean? Now, remember biblically that when we talk about heart, it means the core of an individual. It's not an anatomical part. The heart of an individual, scripturally, refers to the person. This is the meaning behind the title of our Lord, the Sacred Heart of Jesus. We see the image of the heart revealed to Margaret Mary, but what it indicates is not only the revelation of our Lord's human love, the redemptive love for us, it also indicates the uncreated love of the divinity, both of them, because that is the core, the heart, the reality. So what St. Paul is saying to us is that your very being and how you perceive your eyes of that being, the eyes of your heart to be enlightened, that you may know what is the hope. This is very, very consoling. That as we enter into this life of Christ, it is to become more and more hopeful. Even when everything is collapsing and burning around us, we are solidly illuminated interiorly in our lives of that profound sense of hope in his calling, in Christ's vocation to accomplish these things, and so that we are to know what our St. Paul continues to know, what are the riches of the glory of his heritage, his inheritance among the saints, meaning among the consecrated ones. To see that reality of Christ in our own lives and in the reality as it lives in the church. This is why on Wednesday evening with the adults, we spend so much time already in history. To know where we come from, to know who we are, and ultimately to know that mystery of Christ, because every generation that lives is an epiphany of something of the mystery of the work of redemption. Even in the chaos of the 21st century. Because the chaos is apparent. God is still always in charge. And providence always guides everything. So this is a very beautiful vision that lays out everything. I can only encourage you to go back and read, because what we've just spent 15 minutes on has only been two lines of this epistle today. Read that first chapter. And what I leave you with is to understand that what St. Paul is asking of this illumination for each of us, to know Christ and therefore to be able to live in Christ, is to come, he says, to know the operation of God's power within us. And so he links the resurrection and our Lord's glory, he links it to the church, the reality of Christ in time and space, and he links it to our Lord's appearance again in the parousia. So that what he gives is this vision of our Lord in glory, extolled beyond all of the angelic and celestial realm, of every name in existence that he talks about. And St. John Chrysostom in his sermon gives a vision the awe-inspiring aspect that all of what exists, all of creation, will bow down before this glorified Rabbi of Nazareth, before a man. All of the angels themselves will be down in homage before his glory. And he says, and yet, that majesty of our Lord is less than the reality of him as head of the church. Because while that is majesty and awe, and we watch the stars and the angels and the planets and everything else bow before our Lord, which, by the way, is why we've chosen the liturgy of St. James today. That is majestic. But the work of redemption, of illumination, and of healing, and of wisdom, and of revelation is still greater than that awe of majesty. And therefore, the gift that has been given to us to be able to learn within that body, which we call the church, St. Paul says, is more significant. Because what was exercised first in our Lord is exercised in his disciples, day after day, week after week. So that his glory and the headship over the church, he speaks of it as being a compliment. And that's the point just to leave you with. What St. Paul says in this chapter is not that just what is accomplished in Christ historically, death, resurrection, ascension, glory, it is complemented, it is filled out by his body, which is the church. Which means in a personal life, in our life, that everything that was done within our Lord is expanded throughout the church. Not that it adds anything to his glory, but it develops in the full riches throughout time and space and history what could not be seen in those few years' time in Jerusalem and Nazareth and Galilee 2,000 years ago. That's why he speaks of the church as being a complement. So when I leave you with this idea of the grace of wisdom and revelation and illumination, of light and of hope, it's to understand that what we have been called to do in our own personal little lives, as insignificant as we may think they are, as disciples of the Lord and living in Christ, we are meant to be another chapter of those Gospels once written, manifesting in Christ that life of our Lord in 2018. That is an awe-inspiring vocation. And that is one of profound hope and beauty. And that is why, as disciples, let us move towards our Lord. Open our ears. Listen and enter into that enlightenment of profound hope. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.